So I don't have to use this, do I? I can put this away. Well, thank you for the introduction. I'm fond of saying I came here 32 years ago now for a two-year fellowship, and I'm still working on it. I'll get it done. I came here because in the 1970s, Vanderbilt was known nationally and internationally for a discipline called clinical pharmacology, which I bet many of you have heard of and not many of you could define. I can define it because I grew up there, and I actually directed the division for about 15 years. And clinical pharmacology is the science of trying to understand why nobody responds to drugs in exactly the same way. And that's sort of morphed over the years to personalized medicine. So I'll give you a little bit of background in genes and other things that make people respond differently to drugs. That's been my career. I'm also a cardiologist, and I'm interested in heart rhythms. And there's a whole personalized medicine piece in heart rhythms and cardiology. If I say something really stupid, wave at me. But I can talk for hours. So this was the title that I was assigned. I have a remote control, so I don't have to stand here and look at this thing. It's very distracting. When I point, I'm going to have to point at one screen. So I'm going to point at the middle screen, I think. So this is the roadmap for where we're going to be. A little bit of history, a little bit about what genes are and what DNA is, a little bit of lessons about how that works, and how genetics are important in determining how we turn out as people, and then a little bit of a glimpse into the future. If you remember nothing else, just remember this part here. We really are a national and international leader, and I'll convince you of that. I mean, I think I'll convince you of that. So I was introduced as a Canadian, and I grew up in Montreal and never thought I would end up here. But my parents are from a small country in the middle of Europe. My parents are both from Prague. And so I grew up half Czech and half Canadian. And I'm not American, if truth be told. So the story starts, parochially enough, with a fingerprint. Now, we all know that we differ from each other in our fingerprints. Everybody who watches, you know, CSI or any of those shows could tell you that. But you may not know that the first person to describe the idea that there are differences among human beings in their fingerprints was this man, and I bet you nobody in the audience knows who this is. This is a man whose last name is Purkinje. That's the proper way to pronounce it. He's Czech. He was a very eminent Czech scientist who made many contributions to brain, heart, and fingerprint physiology. And so he actually grew up in a small town, or was born in a small town just north of Prague. Well, I can spell it the Czech way, or I can spell it the English way. So if you talk to somebody in this part of the world, it's Purkinje. But that's not the way he would have pronounced it. He would have pronounced it Purkinje, P-U-R-K-Y-N-E, with a little doodad over the N to make it a ny instead of a n. But that's, you didn't come here to learn Czech. So the other part of this map, there are a couple of interesting things on this map that you might or might not know. This town called České Budějovice gives its name to something that we all know and some of us would even love, and that's Budweiser. The Czech, the German name for Budějovice is Budweiser. And you may or may not recognize this town as Plzeň, a great armaments town, but also gave its name to this kind of beer. So Czech beer is the best and most famous beer in the world. And that, take it from me as a Czech. That's true. So I'm fond of starting the story with these two pictures. And people look at these pictures and say, oh, it's the same kid. And I think many of you might think the same thing. This is my son, Mark, when he was about 2.5. This is my grandson, Thomas, when he's about 2.5. And this is Mark now with his son, Thomas. So appearances run in families. Genes are important. And I'll try to explain to you how some of that familial resemblance works. Although at the end of the day, this is a trait that we actually don't understand. Why is it that people look like their parents? That's not just one little gene. That's a whole bunch of different things that determine that. So the story really starts, again, parochially enough, in Central Europe, in Moravia, which is right next to Bohemia, all part of the Czech Republic, with this man, Gregor Mendel, the monk who studied peas. And what Mendel did, and this is an experiment which I want to go through for you because the results are directly relevant and interesting to the way we think about human disease now. He was breeding pea plants, and you can actually go to the internet and read his original long discussion. It goes on for dozens and dozens of pages about his results. But in cartoon form, what he did was he took two kinds of pea plants, one with crinkly peas and one with smooth peas, and bred them to each other. It didn't matter whether he breeds them this way or this way, but he bred them, and in the children's generation, the next generation, all the peas are smooth. They're not crinkly at all. And then he did a clever thing. He just pollinated each of them with themselves. You can do that with peas. You can't do that with people, but you can do that with peas. And in the grandchildren's generation, for every four pods he would look at, three would have smooth peas and one would have crinkly peas. And when he reports his results, people argue about whether he faked some of the results, but you know, he didn't do three in one. He did 10,000 and 2,500, and the numbers are all there. It's a pretty complicated mathematical analysis, even for somebody in the middle of the 19th century. So hold that thought, because we'll come back to where this 3-to-1 ratio comes from, because it's not very complicated, but I have to go through some genetics to explain it to you. The next big step for all of us was these two guys. This is Watson and Crick, who in the early 1950s were using X-rays to study the structure of this molecule called DNA. And it had become pretty clear that DNA, which I'll tell you a little bit more about in a second, was somehow involved in transmitting information from one generation to another. But how that works chemically was really not known. So they published this paper. They were in a race with other people. They won that race. They were in a race with Linus Pauling. Many of you have heard of Linus Pauling, because he won two Nobel Prizes, one for chemistry and one for peace. And he proposed a structure for DNA around the same time, which turns out to have been wrong. He had the triple helix. This is the double helix, and this is the right answer. And this is the paper that, you know, won the Nobel Prize and really changed the face of modern science. It was a 900-word paper published in the journal Nature in 1953. So it starts off with this quote, which I have to stand over here to read. "We wish to suggest a structure for the salt of deoxyribonucleic acid DNA. The structure has novel features which are of considerable biological interest." That's a typical British understatement. and then I think in one of the most famous lines in the scientific literature, they write this thing down here that says, "It has not escaped our notice that the specific pairing we have postulated immediately suggests a possible copying mechanism for the genetic material." So they have a structure. That's what they do. They study structure, and they get the structure, and they say, oh, look, if this structure is what we think it is, then that immediately tells us how it is that peas and people transmit information from one generation to the next. So here's the idea. This is the structure of DNA, and everybody's intrigued by the double helix. That's the backbone. That's the uninteresting part, in fact. It's these little rungs of the ladder in between that are really important. And if you notice in the picture, whenever there's a green, there's sort of a red, and when there's a yellow, there's a blue. And they always pair up like that. And we have names for those. The short names are ACT and G. G and C always go together, and T and A always go together. So whenever there's an A on this side, there'll be a T on this side. Whenever there's a G on this side, there's a C. C, G, T. See how that works? Okay, so that's the molecule. That's what Crick and Watson had. And what they noticed, and these little dots here are the bonds that hold the whole mess together. But those bonds are not terribly strong. They can be broken. And what they noticed is that you could unfold it. And if you unfold it, then that's each side is a template for replication. And then you can make a new strand. So out of one strand of DNA, if this process works right, you get two. And each one of them is an exact copy of the mother molecule, the two daughter molecules. Or exact copies of the mother. So you have a cell, and the cell has information in it. And the information is encoded in these long strands of DNA, and I'll tell you how that works in a second, but just this is the idea. Here's a cell, and it goes through that process and it duplicates its DNA. So it could do that, and Watson and Crick figured out that that's sort of how it must work. And then when the cell divides, each cell gets half of this, what's left, and you have two daughter cells that are exact duplicates of the mother. So those could be P cells, those could be human cells. It gets a little more complicated as we make new human beings. So this is the mother, and you have, I draw it as two genes, because you have all DNA exists in paired form, and I'll come back to the paired form in a second. So you have the gene for hair color might be, you have two copies. The gene for skin color, the gene for drug response, the gene for whatever, and I'll come back to all those in a second. In every cell in the body, that's the way it works, except for one kind of cell, and that's the cell in the ovary, the ovum. The egg cell gets one copy, gets either copy A or copy B. So there are egg cells, and in every prepubertal girl, the egg cells are sitting there like this, and then puberty comes, and then they can replicate, they can reproduce. The dad's the same way. The sperm cells are different from all the other cells in the body because they only have one copy of the genetic information. They have half the genetic information that every other cell has. So when a sperm meets an egg, you generate a new human being. Part of the information comes from mom, part of it comes from dad, and the piece that comes from mom is either the top piece or the bottom piece, and the same for dad. So on average, when this happens over and over and over and over again, there are four different ways in which you can make a new human being. And that's for one gene, and we have many, many genes. So that's why people don't look exactly like their parents, but they look sort of like their parents. And we'll come back to that idea in a little bit. So what do I mean when I say information? So it turns out that if you look at a cell and look in the nucleus, there are these little clumps. And if you can blow up the clumps, blow them up with a very powerful microscope, you see long strands of DNA. But it's the way I've shown it so far is sort of as an unfolded ladder. But DNA sort of clumps up on itself in these little clumps like that. And that's why we can see it. And every so often it unfolds. And when it unfolds, that's the piece that might be duplicating itself, for example. So the piece this is the way it works. And there are 23 what we call chromosomes. And I'll show you more about chromosomes in a second. And they're in pairs. There are actually 22 in pairs, and then the sex chromosomes. So why is DNA important? DNA itself just carries the code. All those letters encode proteins. And proteins are the building blocks of what it is that make us human beings. So there are proteins called collagen that hold us together. There are proteins called myosin, which make hearts beat and not. There are proteins that subserve every single function that you might want in a human body. So DNA just carries the code. It's the protein that does the work. So this is a map of what the human genome looks like, organized by chromosomes. So we have chromosomes numbered 1 through 22. They're in pairs, so there are 44 of them. And then each one of us has two sex chromosomes. Women have two X chromosomes. Men have an X chromosome and a Y chromosome. You know, the gene for controlling the remote control is on the Y chromosome, right? The air guitar gene is on the Y chromosome. So that's a male joke, sorry. So, and you notice that, I mean, the numbering system is not very complicated. One is the biggest and 22 is the smallest. And these numbers here are important for me because they tell me that this thing has 247 million letters. And that it carries the code for about 3,000 genes. Each one of those genes makes one protein. We were learning that genes make lots of different proteins. So the total is about 3 billion letters and 25,000 genes, and each one of them makes one or more proteins. We think there's something like 100 to 300,000 proteins that together make up a human body. So that's the dictionary, so to speak. Now, when we talk about the genome, what we mean is the collection of all the genes. This is a genome. So Thomas Roden has a genome. Peas have a genome. Rice has a very complicated genome, interestingly. Rice's genome is twice as complicated as ours. I'm not sure what it is that rice does that's so complicated, but it is. Mastodon genomes have been isolated. Chimpanzee genomes have been studied. Tyrannosaurus rex did have a genome, and I'm not sure we can replicate it like in Jurassic Park. Your pet dog has a genome. This is a scientist named Svante Paavo, who was here about a year and a half ago. He was the one who sequenced the Neanderthal genome. So this is him, and this is the skull of a Neanderthal. He gives a very compelling lecture about the differences and similarities between human and Neanderthal genomes. So it's really an exploding science, and the tools to do this sequencing are really dramatically getting better. You've all heard of Moore's Law, or you may have heard of Moore's Law. Moore's Law says that the power in a computer doubles every 18 months. And all of us in this room, I look around the room and I see how old people, all of us in this room have experienced the doubling from the introduction of the personal computer to now. The cost of getting genetic information drops much faster than Moore's law now. So 10 years ago it would cost $100 million to sequence a human genome. Today it costs probably something under $1,000. So we're all going to have that, we're all going to be able to do that maybe. I don't know if we want to, but we can't. So I said before I'm an arrhythmia doctor. I take care of patients with heart rhythm problems. And these are three of my partners. And when you look at them, it's pretty obvious that they carry different genetic codes, right? So what is it that makes people different? What do genetic variations look like? So the commonest kind of genetic variation is this. So here's another cell, and it has a big strand of DNA in it that's sort of folded up, and now it's unfolded just so you can read the sequence. And the bottom sequence reads AGACTCGCT. So that's that sequenced right down there. And you notice the pairing, just like I said before, but we're only interested in the bottom strand. So that's what it looks like in what we would call the reference sequence. We're never sure what the right term is. Everybody's genome is different, so which is the one to which we should compare everybody else? But there's a reference sequence. And occasionally, you get a different letter right here. So that's what we call a single nucleotide polymorphism. Nobody wants to remember that. So we call it a SNP. And we pronounce it SNP. It's an SNP. So there are, if I compare me and you, there are 15 million SNPs that make us different from each other. Some of them are common. Sometimes you can find one where 30% of the room has one variant and 70% of the room has another. Sometimes you find them that are unique to me. There are probably 150 that are unique to me and my family that no one else in the world has or has seen. So we're just learning about the rare ones because they've been harder to find. So what do genetic variants do? Well, they're the things that drive the differences among my three partners in skin color, in attitudes, in all kinds of things, interacting with an environment, you know, how they were brought up. But most of the SNPs, I think you can sort of take it as on face value right now, they either do nothing or we don't know what they do. But they're not very important for biology right now, we think. The presence of a genetic variant can cause a rare disease, and I'll talk to you a little bit about that, can make you more or less susceptible to some common disease, like having a heart attack or having breast cancer or prostate cancer or having an abnormal heart rhythm, for that matter. And then it can predispose to unusual reactions to drugs, and that's sort of how I get into this in the first place, so I'll talk a little bit about that in a second. So, rare diseases. Here's an actual picture of human chromosomes. This is a boy, and he has two chromosome 2s, two chromosome 3s, and you can see all the way down to chromosome 22 and a Y and an X, and that's normal. And here's another one that's not normal, and it's one of those, you know, find the difference between these two. But we're not going to spend a long time. The difference is that there's three copies of chromosome 21. So that's called trisomy 21. You'd think that, you know, an extra copy couldn't be bad for you, but this is what causes Down syndrome. Down syndrome. So this is Down syndrome. So Down syndrome is a pretty common birth defect. This is a Christmas card I got from one of my fellows who spent 5 years with us. He's from Japan. He has two sons, and you can immediately tell which son has Down syndrome. They all look similar. They all have they're all susceptible to cardiac diseases. They have varying degrees of cognitive dysfunction. This is a very high-functioning Down's child. Some of them are not so high-functioning. But they all look the same, and that has something to do with the fact that they have an extra chromosome 21, and people are busy sorting out how that works. But that's a genetic defect that causes a disease that's not a SNP. That's a big, big, big duplication. These are five diseases where a single genetic variant, a single SNP, people don't like to use the word SNP for disease-causing things, but we call them mutations, actually cause the disease. So this is a chest X-ray of an 18-year-old who has cystic fibrosis. And you may or may not be used to looking at chest X-rays, but there's way too much white stuff here, and it's way too fluffy. These are four members of a family, all of whom are tall, very skinny, have very long arms, very long legs, and these really strikingly long fingers. And they have something called Marfan syndrome. Marfan syndrome affects the aorta, the main blood vessel out of the heart, and causes it to balloon. And so these people are at pretty high risk of dying from burst aortas. There was a woman basketball player on the Olympic basketball team named Flo Hyman who had Marfan syndrome and died of this. And the reason she got on the basket on the volleyball team, the volleyball team, I said basketball, didn't I? Mm-hmm. The reason she got on the volleyball team was because she was tall and had long arms, right? This is a disease that actually is pretty common, but in its most extreme form causes very, very high cholesterol and disease in the coronary and other arteries. This is a picture of normal blood cells, and this cell here is a funny shape, and that's a sickle cell. So that's a common genetic disease. And this is a 2x, two mammograms, a normal one and an abnormal one with an obvious lump in it, and that's breast cancer. Now, breast cancer is not usually caused by a single genetic defect. There are many, many factors that go into breast cancer, but it is a fact that if you have a family history of breast cancer, you are more susceptible to having breast cancer. And there are certain genetic abnormalities that dramatically increase that risk. So let me tell you a little bit about inheritance, because when people start to think about these genetic diseases, people start to think about, well, if there's something like that in my family, am I at risk for getting it or not? So the way it works in my clinic is that somebody shows up with one of these genetic diseases. There are genetic diseases that affect the heart rhythm, so that brings my two lives together in my genetic clinic. And I'll see a patient who has one of my genetic diseases, and I'll ask, in this case, her, about her family. And this is the way we draw family trees. It occurs to me that you might not be familiar with this. These are the parents, and these are the four children. There are three boys and a girl. And you ask her, well, anybody else in your family have anything? And she says, no, I have three healthy brothers, and my parents are healthy. And we go back and talk a little bit more, and it turns out her father has a sister who has something that sounds like she might have been affected by this disease, and there's a cousin over here who's affected. And then you give up, because taking a family history takes an awfully long time, and people have to go back to talk to their families and figure it out. And so it is true that we're all taught to do this in medical school, and none of us do it very well at all. There's a group of people who call genetic counselors whose job is to figure out what a family tree might look like and to help us and families figure out who's at risk in the family or not. So after you've given up in clinic, you talk to the genetic counselor, and then a month or two later, they come back with something like this. So this is a big tree now, and it turns out that there's a grandmother up here, and the grandmother had a sister who might have had the same disease, and the great-grandmother might have had the same disease. And so you start to think about, well, there are too many people affected with whatever disease this is. This could be Marfan syndrome, for example. To make it be a fluke, so it must be genetic. So what's the how do we decide how it's inherited? So this is an example of a genetic problem that arises because somebody on one of their genes has an abnormal sequence, has a mutation, and the other one is normal. And so this is the way it works in this particular person and this person. And we assume that everybody who's not affected at a first approximation, we assume that they're normal. We'll come back to whether that's a safe assumption or not. So that's the way it works. So remember that this person here has an abnormal gene and a normal gene, and she just transmitted the abnormal gene to her son, and the normal gene comes from the father. So we fill it in a little bit more. This person we assume is affected. This person we assume is affected. Sometimes we can do genetic testing and prove it, but until recently, that's just been an assumption. So this is the pattern we would come up with. And then you're faced with trying to figure out, well, where does this come from if the two parents are normal and if the grandmother is normal? And so you have to make the assumption that if this is familial and this person has an abnormal gene and this one has an abnormal gene, that this person also had an abnormal gene, transmitted it to her son who transmitted it to the daughter. But for reasons that we don't understand, not every single person who has the genetic abnormality actually has the disease. And that's a really important part of modern genetics. We're learning that one gene makes you very, very susceptible but might not cause the disease. So that's an important lesson in this kind of family. We have a technical term for that, which is called variable penetrance. But the idea is that just because somebody says you have a genetic abnormality doesn't mean you have a disease. The other part of this family that's actually pretty important is this one here. If you could do genetic testing and find that they were normal, notice that every single person who's descended from this person here is normal. So once you find someone who doesn't carry the abnormal gene, their descendants won't carry the abnormal gene either. So you can get this, all these cousins here can say, well, whatever it is that this person has, I don't have it. So that's inheritance pattern number one. Marfan syndrome and some of the diseases that make people susceptible to breast cancer fall into that category, many, many other diseases. This is pattern number two. So here's a person who has a genetic disease. You look at their immediate family, there's nobody. You look at the parents, there's nobody. You look at the extended family, there's nobody. So you say, well, what makes you say this is genetic? This could be sickle cell disease, for example. So the way that works is this person is unlucky enough to have two mutations. So they have a mutation in one, the gene that they got from mom, and the gene that they got from dad. So both mom and dad, their genetic makeup looks like this. So remember, I showed you this cartoon before. If you have mom and dad have gene 1 and gene 2 and gene 3 and gene 4, and when you mix and match them, one child in 4 inherits two abnormal genes. One child in 4 inherits two normal genes, and then two children in 4 get one gene that's abnormal from one parent and one gene that's abnormal from the other parent. So the ones that are in pink carry a genetic variant but don't have a disease. So in the case of sickle cell, for example, these are people who have the sickle cell trait. Yes?
Sickle cell, was it prophylactic against malaria?
So there is this idea that the reason we have the reason sickle cell persists, you know, if all these kids who get sickle cell, who get sickle cell anemia in Africa, because it's an African disease, die, then how in the world does this gene propagate? What's the advantage of having this mutation? And it turns out that people with the sickle cell trait are somewhat resistant to getting severe malaria. Their cells, because they sickle, they don't get their malaria doesn't affect them as badly. So there is this idea that there is a survival advantage to having sickle cell the sickle cell trait. There's clearly not a survival advantage to having the sickle cell disease. So there's a couple of things that I think are really interesting about this. First of all, for every 4 children, there's 1 affected and 3 normal. And that's the way the peas work for Mendel. So Mendel was studying what we call a recessive disease. The crinkly pea characteristic means you get an abnormal gene from from both parents. And the way the genetics work is that it's going to be a 3-to-1 ratio, just like it is here. The other comment is that if sickle cell disease, I'll do the math both ways for you. If sickle cell disease is 1 in 2,500 African patients, or cystic fibrosis has exactly the same inheritance pattern, so 1 in 2,500 white kids has cystic fibrosis. That means that about 1 in 30 people is a carrier. The carrier trait is extremely common. So I look around this room, and there must be 4 or 5 or 6 people who are in this situation. And they won't know it. There's no way they will know it unless they happen to mate with another person who also has the cystic fibrosis gene. And even then they won't know it unless they're unlucky enough to have that one child in 4 who has the gene. So 1 in 2,500 means that one time in 600 these matings happen, and one time in 25, so one person in 25 is like this, one person in 25 is like this, so the chances of them finding each other to make a family is 1 in 625, and the chances of them having an abnormal child is 1/4 of that, so it's 1 in 2,500. So although the numbers don't sound like much, when you have these diseases that are caused by 2 genes, the carrier state is very, very common. Does that make sense? Yes? You want to do the math again? I was a math guy before I went to medicine school. Absolutely.
It's not an absolute.
Absolutely. So the 1 in 4, and this is the 1 in, this is 1 in 2. Notice here, I'm going backwards. Yeah, here it's 1 in 2. One child in 2 gets 1 abnormal gene from their parent. Here it's 1 in 4, but it's on average. And the averages are exactly that. It's not unusual to see a family where there's 2 or 3 affected kids, and you say, well, you know, they must have had 12 children, they must have had 16 children in order to get 2 or 3 affected, but they don't. They're just very, very unlucky. So sickle cell disease and cystic fibrosis fall into this category. And when you go back into the family, of course, you know, there's lots and lots of mutation carriers, but they wouldn't know it unless they actually found someone who also was a mutation carrier. So in the year 2012, it is possible to do genetic testing for many, many, and many of these diseases. We know where to look in the genome, and we have technologies that allow us to sequence that particular piece of the genome to tell us whether a person has a disease or not, and whether a relative, therefore, is a carrier or not. So for the diseases like Marfan syndrome, so I will see somebody and I'll say, oh, this person has Marfan syndrome. And I'll do genetic testing, and the genetic testing won't find the mutation. Does that mean I'm a bad doctor? Probably not. It probably means that the technology isn't good enough to find every single mutation, or there are other genes that we should be looking in that we just don't know yet. Those are the possible. So genetic testing for specific rare diseases has a catch rate of somewhere between 40 and 80%, depending on how good we are. We always start with testing the patient. So somebody comes in and says, you know, my sister has Marfan syndrome, I want to be tested. I said, no, I want to test your sister, because if I don't find the mutation in your sister, I'm certainly not going to find it in you. And sometimes we find a change and we don't know if it causes the disease. That's becoming a big, big issue for us. So as we start to sequence everybody's genome in this room, we might find people who have a mutation in the Marfan gene. You know, they don't look like they have Marfan syndrome. Does that mean their kids might have Marfan syndrome? Or does that mean they should get an X-ray of their aorta every year? Those are all questions that we're just beginning to start to sort through. One of the biggest parts of genetic testing is getting family members off the hook. I showed you that whole family on the left-hand side of the first example, where once you know that the grandfather doesn't have the genetic defect, none of the offspring will have it. Sometimes knowing the specific mutation actually makes us smarter about treating a particular patient, knowing that it's this mutation and not that mutation. And we really don't know what to do with people who carry a genetic variant but who don't have a disease. So it's a really, you know, doing the genetic testing in everybody opens up a real can of worms. So those are rare diseases that cause spectacular human diseases, rare genetic variants that cause spectacular human diseases. We also have the situation, increasingly you can open your newspaper and read about somebody finding the gene for heart disease, or finding the gene for abnormal rhythm, or finding the gene for cancer, or finding the gene for whatever. And I'm fond of showing this quotation. This is Paul Dudley White. Paul Dudley White was one of the founders of American cardiology, Boston physician in the 1940s and 50s, and really sort of founded the discipline. And he made the observation in 1960 that atherosclerosis, hardening of the arteries, runs in families. And the mechanism by which the inheritance occurs is a mystery. I'm fond of saying when I show this that we're actually solving Dr. White's mystery through technologies that are only possible in the last 5 years in terms of scanning large swaths of the genome and trying to find common genetic variants that predispose us to things like a hardening of the arteries. And we're pretty good. There's a catalog that is published on the web. And the catalog has studied 1,000 different human traits. So high blood pressure, high cholesterol, various kinds of cancer, various kinds of diabetes. You name it, it's been studied. Restless leg syndrome, whether you have dry or wet earwax, whether your urine smells after you eat asparagus. All those things have been analyzed this way. Actually, it turns out, I didn't know this, it turns out everybody's urine smells after they eat asparagus. But some people can't smell that smell, and some people can. Now you know. So that's been studied. But leaving aside things like earwax and asparagus, but you know, important diseases like high cholesterol or high blood pressure, we found genetic variants that increase your risk of having that maybe 20%, maybe 50%. Now, if you're going to turn to somebody and say, well, your chance of having high blood pressure is increased 20%, and the person will say, well, should I take a high blood pressure medicine? And the answer is, you'd have to have a medicine that was really, really effective and caused absolutely no side effects for to treat something that's that trivial an increase in risk. So the answer is, all this is really interesting, but we really don't have tools to treat patients. What we do, yes, what we do is use this kind of information to point us to new genes. And the new genes could be new targets for drug action. They could be new ways of thinking about diseases. That's the real advantage of this kind of technology. Yes?
How are health insurance companies dealing with, you know, once you identify something in someone,
and
then do they call that a pre-existing condition and not cover it?
Right. So there's a lot of concern in the genetics community about discrimination on the basis of health insurance. One of the very few things that everybody on all sides of the political spectrum could agree on during the late part of the Bush administration, last Bush administration, was that that was a bad idea. So there's something called the Genetic Information Non-Discrimination Act, GINA, which was finally passed after sort of seven tries. And GINA basically says you're not allowed to do that. It's not a perfect law, though. Things like long-term disability, they can still discriminate against you for this. The problem is that if an insurance carrier were to say, do you have a family history of breast cancer, and you'd say, yes, three members of my family have breast cancer, that's not considered a pre-existing condition. But if you then do a genetic test and find the mechanism for all three of those people having breast cancer, and you have the same genetic abnormality or the genetic variant, then that's a pre-existing condition. So I think the family history is the thing that they should be focused on. And the fact is that everybody in this room has genetic abnormalities. We just sometimes don't know what they are. Most of the time we don't know what they are. So it's I'm drawing a distinction, at least, and I can draw it in my own mind, I probably haven't transmitted it right, between the idea that there are genetic variants that have a high impact on health, Marfan syndrome and all those other things. And it turns out there's lots and lots of examples of that. And then these genetic variants that we are beginning to understand have a really very modest impact on health. And so the real concern about this is not at the level of genetic discrimination. The real concern is that companies actually advertise directly to the consumer and say, here, do a genetic test and find out if you're susceptible to X or Y or Z. And I must say, I've done that testing, and it's sort of fun to find out about yourself, but you don't find out something that says, you know, you should change your lifestyle immediately, because you just find out that so I have a 25% increased risk for macular degeneration. It's sort of interesting. I hope it doesn't happen. It doesn't mean it's going to happen. And it just sort of tells you something about yourself. I'm lecturing to the second year medical class at Vanderbilt this afternoon about direct-to-consumer genetic testing, and it's an interesting area. Some people argue it's your genome, you might as well know about it, but there's not much to say about it beyond isn't that interesting. except for this. So there are genetic variants that are common that sit there in your genome and do nothing until you're exposed to a drug, and then they make it so that you respond differently to a drug than your next door neighbor. And that's obviously something I've been sort of interested in. Does anybody recognize this pill? I have to ask. Plavix. This is Plavix. 75 milligrams of Plavix, and some of you may take it and not recognize it. It may not come in this form anymore. It's about to be generic. Which is good and bad. So everybody who's had a stent stuck in their coronary artery is told to take Plavix or something like Plavix, usually Plavix though. And the reason is that studies like this have been done that show that if you don't take Plavix, your incidence of having something bad happen to you in the 30 days after you get a stent is about 8%, and if you take Plavix, it's about 4.5%. And faced with data like that, you'd say, well, you'd be an idiot not to take Plavix. Of course, Plavix doesn't confer immortality. Taking a placebo instead of Plavix doesn't mean you're going to drop dead tomorrow. But there is a difference, and unless you have some reason not to take Plavix, you should take Plavix. Well, it turns out that about 20% of this room has a single genetic variant, and actually 2% of you have two copies of that genetic variant that prevents Plavix from working well. And it prevents probiotics from working particularly well in patients who have had coronary stenting, so that's a big deal. And I have to show this picture. This is a picture of one of my mentors at Vanderbilt, a man named Grant Wilkinson, who in the middle of the 1980s discovered an enzyme that was absent in about 4% of the people he was studying. He was studying a drug that no one has ever heard of and no one to this day has ever prescribed. And I used to give him a hard time. I said, Grant, why are you studying this drug that nobody cares about? And you know, it was one of those science for science's sake or to understand broad principles. And it turns out that the enzyme that he was studying is the enzyme that activates Plavix. So it turns out that there is an important piece of this story that involves very basic science that gets translated to the bedside eventually. And some of that happened at Vanderbilt. Anybody recognize this pill? I bet Coumadin, right? So Coumadin or warfarin, widely used anticoagulant. There are other drugs on the market now that may supplant Coumadin. And if you look at large groups of people who get Coumadin, this is the kind of distribution you see. Some people take 1 milligram a day, some people take 15 milligrams a day. Most people take somewhere between 3 and 7 milligrams a day. And the reason there's that tremendous variability is genetics, is that some people have the ability to metabolize Coumadin quickly and need high doses. Some people don't have the ability to metabolize it and they need low doses. Too much Coumadin makes you bleed. Yes? Absolutely. So when we look at variability in Coumadin, we can do the math, it turns out, and about 50% of the variability is from genetics. And then there's another chunk that's from things like age and how fat you are, and then there's another chunk that we don't understand. In the case of Coumadin, diet is a big deal. Depends on how much leafy greens you have, because what Coumadin does is it antagonizes the effect of vitamin K in the body, and there are vegetables that have lots of vitamin K in them, and so there's a big interaction with diet. But this is an example of something where there's a big genetic effect. 50% is a big genetic effect. So the other area that's gotten a lot of press recently that I think is worth just you knowing about is cancer. So cancer cells are different from all the other cells in your body. They start out normal, and they start out with that normal complement of 46 chromosomes, but what makes them cancer is that they get mutations along the way. They acquire mutations for reasons that we are just beginning to understand. And so you might end up with a cancer cell that has 92 chromosomes or 86 chromosomes or 47 chromosomes or mutations in places that are just mutated in the cancer. And some of those mutations we're actually beginning to understand are the things that make you have cancer. They actually create new molecules in the body, and those new molecules make those cells proliferate like crazy. So the idea is that there are cells that don't have the ability to turn off their proliferation, and if you could figure out what it is that drives that, what mutation drives that, and turn develop medicines to target that particular problem, you could actually cure the cancers. That's been promising enough to make the cover of Time magazine and will be a Nobel Prize within the next couple of years. The first medicine to do that was a medicine called Gleevec for chronic myelogenous leukemia. And there are many other examples now. This is a picture that I debated about showing. It's a little on the gruesome side, but it makes a point. These are four different examples of malignant melanoma, very terrible skin cancer. And this is one that comes from skin without sun damage, with sun damage, arising from skin inside the mouth, and then this arises from under the armpit, say. So those are, and if you're a dermatologist in 1980, you look at your patient and say, well, this one comes from inside the mouth, and therefore I'm going to treat it this way. You subdivide the tumors by where they came from, what they look like. And what the cancer guys are doing now is they're saying, well, wait a second, we can actually look at the cancer sequence, not the sequence of the person, but the sequence of their tumor, and we can identify mutations in genes called BRAF or NRAS or KIT, and the mutations are what tells us how to treat the disease, not where it comes from or what it looks like. So it's a much more sophisticated form, and BRAF is particularly interesting. It's a growth factor, and it's mutated in certain forms of melanoma and other kinds of cancers. And there's one common mutation in those cancers. People have developed a drug that blocks the activity of that common mutation. Here's a picture of a person who was exposed to a drug that now has a name because it's marketed, but when this picture was done, it wasn't marketed. This is called a PET scan, and each one of these dots here is a melanoma focus, all these dots here. This is the brain, that's not a melanoma focus, that's just normal scanning, and this is the bladder, that's also normal. But all this person is riddled with tumor. This person is in the last stages of the disease. 2 weeks after getting a dose of this medicine, it's gone. Now, it's not gone completely, but this is something really, really remarkable. And so this is the future of cancer therapy. And I want to show you that, I mean, this was in the New England Journal of Medicine. It's been a huge advance. This medicine, progressed to now being marketed. And I just want to show you, where the scans were done, where the studies were done. Right. So how am I doing? Okay. So what we do in genetics at Vanderbilt, finding mutations in patients with genetic diseases, I've talked a lot about that because it's fun to think about it, and you do help families, understanding what it is that makes that genetic abnormality cause the disease, testing new treatments, finding genetic contributors to common diseases, and that's something we're doing in the Vanderbilt DNA Bank, which I'll tell you about in a second, and then we're starting to use genetic information in actually taking care of patients, and I'll tell you about that right now. So, here's the vision. So this woman, if I prescribed Plavix, I would, if I was smart and thought genetics were important, I would get a genetic test. And then when my patient goes home on their dose of Plavix, I get the genetic test result a couple of hours or a couple of days later. I look at the test, and then I try to remember who that patient was, why were they being treated, and then I look at the result, and I try to figure out, well, is that a normal dose, or is that a normal genetic test, or not a normal genetic, what am I supposed to do with this result? So most people don't do it, those do genetic testing, because it's just a cumbersome pain in the rear. But if you have all your genetic information already available, then just handing it to the pharmacist and saying, here, you do it and get it right, has a tremendous appeal. The reason this appears in the New Yorker in the year 2000 is because that's when the first human genome sequence was finished. Now, in the early part of the 2000s, you could read your Wall Street Journal and see, get a story about genetic testing every second day. And I particularly like this one, Mayo Clinic plans database of every patient history, including genetic makeup. And I like to show that because I will tell you that Mayo Clinic plans, Vanderbilt does. So we have a project here called BioView. Many of you may be familiar with it. These brochures are all over the internal medicine clinic, and it accrues DNA from patients who are seen at Vanderbilt. The design and the mechanics of doing it are complicated, and I'm happy to talk about that afterwards. But as of this week, there are samples from 137,000 patients in the bank. We're doing a lot of work that's big enough to do a lot of research in, and it's been one of the things that's catapulted us into a leadership position nationally and internationally, the access to these data and the ability to mine them. One of the things that we've done is we've become part of a network that's sponsored by the National Institutes of Health. There were five centers, and their job in life was to figure out how to get electronic medical records to talk to genetic information. And that's what we want to do. And the five centers are University of Washington, Marshfield Clinic, Mayo Clinic, Northwestern, and us. And these are the sizes of the banks. And I just want to point out the Mayo Bank, okay, and point out the Vanderbilt Bank. So I'm totally serious. This is the largest bank of its kind in the world that's attached to an academic center. It's the largest bank of its kind that's attached to electronic medical records. There are large banks in Northern California. There are large banks in Pennsylvania, but they're not as big and they're not attached to electronic records. So this really is an interesting time for us. So one of the other things that the cancer doctors want to do is they're sequencing cancers and they're finding mutations. And an obvious question for a cancer doctor is, I've sequenced the patient's cancer, I found this mutation. Has anyone ever seen this before? Is there a clinical trial going on with this for this particular kind of cancer, this particular mutation? So there's a site called My Cancer Genome which the cancer guys use all the time to interrogate whether their particular mutation in their patient has been seen before, and if it's been seen before, are there clinical trials for that particular variant? And you can't see it down here, but it's hosted at the Vanderbilt Ingram Cancer Center. This is the brainchild of the director of hematology oncology here, William Powell. And then we have a project here called PREDICT. PREDICT stands for this. And the idea is to use the genetic information that we've accumulated over the last 3 decades of studying variable drug responses to actually improve the way people take care of, people are taken care of with medicines like warfarin or Plavix. We've been doing this since the fall of 2010, and we've studied over 4,000 patients now. This is the way genetic information is displayed, and what I want to show you is that over the 4,000 patients that we have studied, there are 103, that's about 2.5%, that have two copies of two abnormal copies of the gene that is responsible for mediating Plavix effects. That's about right. And then there's another 774 who have one normal copy and one abnormal copy. So that means altogether, out of these 4,237 people, there were 877 in whom Plavix would be predicted to not work as well as the rest. And I like this picture. This is a picture of John McPherson, one of the cardiologists who puts stents into people's bodies, and one of his patients, the first patient in this PREDICT project, who was identified as being one of these 103 people here. So after her stent, she doesn't get an ordinary dose of Plavix. She gets something else. Yes? Yes?
I was exploring the site My Health at Vanderbilt.
Uh-huh.
And I discovered that I was a Plavix person.
Uh-huh.
So, and I wonder, when was I tested?
You, without going into your medical history in public, you probably had a heart catheterization in the last 2 years. That would be the most common situation. Have you had one? No. So there's... So the idea around PREDICT is to find people who are at risk for having exposure to a drug. And the easiest place to do that in the year 2010 was the heart catheterization laboratory. And the reason we're doing this project is to prove to ourselves and insurance companies that this is a useful thing to have I'm answering your question in a slow way. So the first group of people, the first 4,000 or so who were tested, almost all of those people came from patients who were going to have a heart catheterization. We didn't wait until the Plavix was prescribed. We did it in every single person. Only about 40% of those people go on to get Plavix. In the last 3 to 6 months, there's been a lot of effort around trying to figure out who is at risk for getting Plavix. Who has diseases? Who has risk factors for getting drugs like Plavix, like warfarin, like there's a group of about a dozen drugs. And using the information technology we call informatics, there's an effort underway to identify people who are at risk. Now, I'm embarrassed that you ask, because if you're tested, you're supposed to be told that you were tested. You're supposed to be offered the opportunity not to get tested. And I bet you I know who your internal medicine doctor is. Because
I will ask him the next time.
I think that's the best answer.
What I was going to say, my eye doctor, I have a macular degeneration, is not at Vanderbilt.
Uh-huh.
And I was given a DNA test to test the possibility of, I at that point, I had a wet eye and a dry eye.
Right.
And they swabbed my cheek.
Uh-huh. The wet, right.
It turns out, if I had gone to the wet, he was going to give me a gadget to take home and was going going to check me every day.
Whoa.
But then it turned out that I had a moderate, so therefore I didn't get the machine,
mm-hmm.
but I went well.
Oh, anyway.
So it was moderate, it could have gone either way. And so, but anyway, that's the only time I've been tested, and that was not at Vanderbilt.
No. No. Well, so somewhere along the line, your internal medicine doctor and you have to have a conversation.
Okay.
I think that's the answer. So this is the way the electronic medical record looks at Vanderbilt right now. Drug reactions, medications, procedures, things like your hematic. These are lab values that are of importance to us, whether you've had a flu vaccine. And in this little blank space right now, we have what the lady who had in the cartoon has. We have the genetics of the response to Plavix predicted. So this is a person who's going to have a poor response to Plavix. The real name for Plavix is clopidogrel. And so on the basis of that, that person should get some other drug. So this is the vision, and we're getting there. We have bumps along the road, obviously. And at the end of the day, what we really want to do is figure out what it is that makes these two guys look the same, act the same, or act differently between themselves and from each other. So I think I will stop there and answer questions, or try to answer questions. So, I feel like I need a moderator. We'll start over there, because I had my back to those guys the entire time. So So the cancer question, the question is, if you're taking care of somebody with prostate cancer, would you, before you biopsy somebody, would you do a DNA test and see if they have cancer or not? The problem is that, the PSA test, you know, is a good example of a test that sort of there's a lot of exuberance around, and there's a lot of controversy about whether it's a useful test or not. Probably useful in some settings, not as useful as people would like it to be. And the genetic testing doesn't give us almost never gives us a yes or no answer. It almost never says, you are going to get this disease, you are not going to get this disease. It just shades the risks, just like the woman who was just talking about the macular degeneration test. It just tells you what the odds are that you're going to go in one direction or another. So if there's a lump in the prostate, you biopsy the lump. And if there's a high PSA that makes the urologist think that there might be prostate cancer, you have to pursue that. The more the risk, the interesting thing would be to tell somebody when they're 20 that they might be at risk for prostate cancer later. They can find that out by asking their father and their grandfather and uncles whether they have prostate cancer. That's one way to do it. But you know, not everybody has a huge family too. So the genetics, I think, are going to be an important part of preventive therapy. Once we sort out what genetic tests are good and what genetic tests are not. And the other thing is that once we find the genes for prostate cancer, then we can maybe figure out what causes prostate cancer. And that would be an important step in the right direction, too. So, yes, and then.
If someone's interested in getting the DNA testing, is Vanderbilt the only place that you can get this done?
There are three places in the country that have programs like Predict. There are a lot of places that are thinking about it, and they think about it because they hear us talk about it. Not being facetious. The Mayo does have a program. They have a guy who really believes that genetic testing will help him select among antidepressants. He was the chief of psychiatry there for 10 years. So he has data, and they have a program going similar to this for patients who come to the psychiatry clinic. And then the other place, interestingly, is also in Tennessee. And it's St. Jude Children's Hospital. Because what happens at St. Jude is children come in the door with acute leukemia. That's the main disease that they treat there. And when a child comes in the door, a knowledgeable clinician can look at that child and say, over the course of the next 6 months, here's a list of 20 medications that you are going to get. And some of those medications have big genetic variability stories around them. So they do the testing as the kids walk in the door. Their program is newer than ours. But it goes through the same kind of growing pains in terms of who and how, and part of the predict program revolves around the question of whether the data are good enough to just incorporate into clinical care. So the FDA label for clopidogrel says do genetic testing. The FDA label for some of the heart rhythm medicines that I use say test the kidney function before you give this drug. And we do that routinely. So there are people who think that we should be doing genetic testing for Plavix, you know, right off the bat. We're probably not quite there yet, but that's the question of whether when it stops being research and when it starts being routine care is pretty close for Plavix. The answer is if you're a patient at Vanderbilt, you can. The internal medicine clinic is now enrolling people in the PREDICT project, and that's going to happen over this spring.
What does it cost?
It costs you nothing. It's a project that Vanderbilt is investing in because we want to accumulate enough patients to be able to turn to an insurance carrier and say the outcomes are different in these patients. We think you guys should be paying for this. So. The front office has decided that this is an important thing to do, and so they're doing it. And they're committed to doing, so far they're committed to doing 10,000 patients. Yes?
It was posted over at Chiefwood from a health site on computer that if women would drink only water, or the main source of beverage would be water, they could eliminate 75% of breast cancer. Doug Kaufman on his program Know the Cause says that 11 types of alcohol have been related to cancer. And so I'm wondering how this compares with the material you have.
So the answer is I don't know anything about the idea of just drinking water and preventing breast cancer. I wouldn't want anybody to walk out of this room and say that the only thing that's important in determining disease is genetics. Genetics sort of, some people say genetics loads the gun, environment pulls the trigger. So the genetics just sort of determine your susceptibility, and then there are lots of other things. Those might be other genetic variants, they might be your diet, they might be things in wine or other things that you eat, might be environmental pollutants, they might be cosmic rays, there might be lots of things that make us actually have a disease. So the interplay between the environment and the genes is interesting. I can't make any specific comment about the breast cancer part. Yes.
Sometimes in the metabolism of a drug, lack of a certain enzyme, like a P650, is that a genetic deficiency or is it a different, it's an underlying condition for some other?
So the question is, when drugs are metabolized in the body, they're metabolized by specific enzymes, and the question is whether deficiency of those enzymes is genetic or not. So. The Plavix story is exactly that. The genetic abnormality is in an enzyme that metabolizes. So sometimes people are born that way. There are also drug interactions that can do exactly the same thing. So it's a little controversial, but the enzyme that metabolizes Plavix, the real name is CYP2C19, CYP2C19. And CYP2C19 is also inhibited by Prilosec. So, which many of you may take or may have heard of as a stomach medicine. So the idea is that if you take Plavix, you probably shouldn't be taking Prilosec, because even if your genetics are normal, you might inhibit the enzyme and therefore have an abnormal response. So it's more than just genetics, but genetics points us to the right, to look in the right place. I'm going to move over to here now. Yes.
Vascular patients or cancer patients, if anybody's doing something like this with reactions to pain medications, which a lot of people react to badly, and then they have pain.
So the question is genetics of reactions to pain medications. One of I told you there's sort of about 12 drugs that we're thinking about as the sort of top tier of drugs in the PREDICT project, and one of them is codeine. Widely used pain medicine, because it turns out that, you know, if you go to the dentist, they give you Tylenol number 3, which is Tylenol and codeine. And 7% of you are pre-programmed not to respond to that. Now, the dentist will say, well, you know, the pain will go away and you just take some more or whatever. But it would be nice to know that, because if you're one of those 7%, you might ask the dentist for something else. So we've known that for a long time, and it's another great example of how having the genetic information in your hand might make us smarter, in your hand or in my hand, might make all of us smarter in terms of prescribing drugs. Pain is complicated. So there are some examples of drugs that are used for pain that are metabolized differently among patients, but then there's the whole issue of pain perception, and there may be SNPs in the genes that encode the receptors that make us more or less sensitive to pain that might also play a role in all this. And sorting that out and teasing out exactly what's important and not is the big challenge for this field. Yes, yeah.
I had breast cancer, and a researcher at Vanderbilt was trying to develop a vaccine, mm-hmm. and he informed my oncologist that I had a spontaneous mutation to P53.
Mm-hmm.
However, it was in 96 and 97. So would my sequence be in your database?
Probably not, because that was a long time ago, and you'd have to tell me a little bit more. But your P53 mutation was in your tumor, or was it in your
tumor.
So P53 is a really interesting gene. It's a gene whose job in life is to prevent us from getting cancer, and mutations in P53 are pretty common. People are born with an abnormal copy of P53, and they may be at increased susceptibility to cancer, but they're probably protected because they have the normal gene as well. But then when they get the normal gene gets mutated or its activity gets inhibited, then cancer can start. So the idea in many cancers is that you're born with a genetic susceptibility, you acquire something else, and people talk about the two-hit theory of cancer. So the answer is, I don't know whether, I do know that your sequence would probably not be in the bank, but P53 is another great example of how it's more complicated than some of the stories I've been telling you. Yes?
Well, we all know the phrase in biomedicine, we take it, it says, this drug may cause one, two, three, four. If you have any symptoms, call your doctor.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's
totally unhelpful, right?
So, I mean, I happen to be taking products for years. So I'm thinking, should I stop?
No. So I didn't emphasize this. So for two reasons. One is that my job here is not to deliver healthcare advice to individuals. But the second is that the study I showed you was 30 days after the stent. So after you've been on Plavix for years, I wouldn't rock that boat at all. It might be really cool to find out that you were one of those unusual metabolizers, because you might have been treating yourself for years with a placebo. But remember, you know, people with placebo, most of them do fine as well. But the answer is that at this point I wouldn't change it. Does that make sense? And the business of the labels and saying, you know, if you have this or if you have that, you know, I've spent a lot of my career interacting with the Food and Drug Administration. I have great sympathy for the way they have to write those labels. They spend years wordsmithing that, getting the words exactly right and looking for but nobody reads them, and even if you read them, you don't know how to interpret them. They say, well, it might cause this and it might cause that, and it is. You know, there's some drug side effects that are really pretty common, and we would love to know about those, and would love to warn people about those. But the fact is that every time you see something abnormal happen to somebody, particularly after they've started a new drug, you have to think that the drug might have been responsible. Yes?
Predisposing to high cholesterol.
Uh-huh.
Does that mean that you have that gene, and no matter how you regulate your diet, trying to prevent that?
No, diet treatment is always the first. So most people have high cholesterol. That comes from a combination of genetics and the environment. The environment usually is the diet. And most cholesterols will come down a little bit when you go on a low cholesterol diet. And a little bit means a lot for some people and nothing for other people. And that's probably genetic as well. And then when your doctor prescribes a statin for you, the amount that the statin reduces your cholesterol is also genetically determined. We have a huge program in that right now, trying to figure out, you know, whether this is a person who needs a lot of statin, a person who needs a little bit of statin, a person whose muscles are going to ache when they get a statin or not. So that's because those are such widely used drugs, and it's such a common problem that there's a big research effort here and many other places to do that. But the answer is that it's all about variability, and the diet is part of it. Yes. Yes.
Do all the Vanderbilt clinicians who are seeing patients today know about your studies that, you know, my clinicians are Vanderbilt, so they, do you tell them?
Oh, so we, you know, I spend my time, you know, going from group to group talking about this. One of the advantages of starting this whole program in the Plavix space is that there are 14 interventional cardiologists. There are 14 guys at Vanderbilt who stick stents in. So we had, I can't count how many meetings with them. And I'm a cardiologist too, so I'm one of their colleagues as well. I don't stick stents in. So they, spending a lot of time trying to sort through how we're going to do this and what we're going to do with the information and how we're going to notify people and what happens at 8 o'clock at night when I get a call from the lab saying your patient is a star two, do something, and the patient's now in Cookville or something. So all the logistics that you can imagine. So the cartoon looks really easy. The lady hands her prescription to the pharmacist and say, you do it. But it's much more complicated than that. So we're sorting through all that. The rollout to general internal medicine, there are more than 14 general internal medicine guys. So that's taking a while, and that's happening all this spring. But we have had lots and lots of grand rounds and internal conferences about this. And people, when they go to the clinic, they see it on the record. They see what I showed you. That, I mean, if your patient's been to the cath lab, whether you're a cardiologist or a hematologist, that's what you see. So people are sort of beginning to get used to at least seeing it and starting to think about what that all means.
So how do we get for sure into your database?
That's interesting. You know, I work with a lot of ethicists, and ethicists spend all their time thinking, how do you make sure people stay out of the database? Or how do you make sure that people know? And so the answer is talk to your internal medicine doctor at Vanderbilt. That's the way to do it right now.
But he's not at Vanderbilt, so I'd have to go to a doctor.
Yeah. You know, we get asked that a lot because, you know, I claim no credit and no blame for what you hear on National Public Radio. That's you know, part of this program, but that's run out of the marketing department, but it's all, you know, it's all part of what we do, and we get, you know, phone calls and emails from people all over the country, because that's a national campaign, saying, you know, how can I get tested for myalgias for my statin? And we've actually had angry phone calls from people saying, you know, I'm in California and I can't come to Vanderbilt, and why can't you just do this for me? So I told you, Vanderbilt's putting its money where its mouth is. This is a program that's costing the institution, you know, a lot of money, because we think that this is the way to improve healthcare. So that's why we're doing it here. Yes.
How are you genetically treating lung cancer?
So the William Powell, the man I just mentioned, William came from Sloan Kettering 2 or 3 years ago. If you see some of the advertising material on television, some of the ads, he's often featured in those. He's a very sort of charismatic, well-spoken cancer guy. He's responsible for my cancer genome, and his thing is lung cancer. So the three cancers that are, you know, currently at the top of the list for my cancer genome and for the personalized cancer medicine program here, lung, melanoma, and breast. Breast, a lot of those data have been around for a long time. Anyone who's had breast cancer in this room, and I suspect there's more than one person who's had breast cancer in this room, will know that they're whether your tumor is ER positive or PR positive or HER positive or not. So lung cancer, what they do is they take the lung cancer when it comes out and they sequence it. They either sequence the whole thing or they look specifically for things like BRAF, V600E, the example I showed you. That's not very common in lung cancer, but there are other kinds of mutations that they look for. That's standard. This is one of the three places in the country where that information then gets stuck in the electronic medical record for anybody to look at and interpret. Not many, it's sort of like the interventional cardiologist. There aren't hundreds and hundreds of people who know what to do with the information, but the cancer guys are all on board with doing it in a personalized way. So it becomes important in selection of initial therapy, and it becomes particularly important in people who have had initial therapy and that hasn't worked. So you really have to go after what the genetic driver for that particular tumor is, and that's what they do here, the Massachusetts General Hospital and Memorial Sloan Kettering, which is where William came from. Yes.
Don't you sign a release to Vanderbilt if they, your blood is going to be used in the DNA bank?
So, so there's two projects that are that I talked about that are. That are people think of as overlapping, and I never do a very good job of distinguishing between the two. But there's the DNA bank, and then there's the PREDICT project. The DNA bank is uses discarded blood samples, and the official. So the complicated answer is the official rules of the game right now are that if you use discarded blood samples, and the electronic record has been stripped of identifiers, so there's a whole army of people who do that, then you actually don't even have to tell the patients you're doing it. Now, we thought when we started our program that that seemed like a boneheaded way to do it. You have to tell the patient something. So that's why the brochures are lying around all the place. And everybody who's been to an internal medicine clinic who you may or may not remember this, but I certainly do because I'm a consumer as well as a deliverer of healthcare here. There's a consent to treat form that everybody signs every year. And above the signature, there's this line in bold that says, you know, you can use my leftover blood for DNA research. And the only samples that we take into the biobank are samples that have that form signed and don't have the little tick box saying, tick here if you don't want to be part of it. We want to make it as easy as we can for people who don't want to be part of this project to just get out. And so if you tick the box, your sample is not part of the part of it. So that's the answer to the DNA bank. So, somebody's pointing to their watch. I can't stand here forever, but it sounds like I can't stand here forever.